I'm just going to give a short talk about my vision and to clarify a little about the things that are going. Can I have my thing? Click on the PowerPoint and then launch as PowerPoint. All of you know me. My name's Alan, and I have just been ordained as the chairman of the board, and I just would like to say that I take this job very seriously. This is a job that has been given to us by the Lord, and we have to pour our hearts and minds into the assignment that He has given to us. And I am your servant. I'm here to serve you, and the Lord Jesus Christ is my boss. So things are going to get done. And I would just like to say that we have just celebrated our 24th anniversary. Amen. But I cannot stand the situation where we are right now. I am so discontented. Actually, to tell you the truth, it was Pastor Sam who made me realize. I was last Christmas Eve after the service, I was coming forward and Pastor Sam meets me and he says, "I thank you for being discontented." I was like, "What?" And then he told me to read this book, the one he preached on this morning. Everybody should read that book. Each and every member of ICF should read that book. It's called Holy Discontentment by Bill Hybels. Yes. So, let me see if this works. All right, these are just my tests. So, if there was one word that I'd like to describe ICF for the next term, it should be service. We're here to serve the Lord and the community. And I've been thinking, why are we not growing as fast as we can? Because we have all the resources. We have the people, we have the money, we have the motivation. Why are we not growing so fast? And just in my mind, I think that there are two main problems. The first one being our organization. And this is a disclaimer, because when you elected us, you expected us to make changes in the church. But this is the board of trustees, and this is the board of the elders. There's a distinct separation with it. And the things that the trustees done also affects the elders. And the things that the elders done affects the trustees, right? We're one church. And I have experienced this, and I am very qualified to talk about this, because I have been in both the elder side and I have been in the trustee side. Because what frequently happens is that the elders will say, "Oh, that's the job of the trustees." And then the trustee says, "Oh, that's the job of the elders." Which is fine, because it sometimes gets acted upon. But then the momentum, the enthusiasm of, for example, the trustees, they want to do something, and then they're going to transfer it over to the elders. By the time it gets to them, they do not see it the way the trustees will see it, and vice versa. So, to me personally, I think that this is not a very, very good system. Although, I'm not proposing changes at this time. I'm just saying that I think it could be better. Now, this one will show that there is actually no accountability. There is no relationship between the two. There is no congregational authority, which is very important. The BOT is the legal personality, meaning the Board of Trustees is the one that gets sued or will be represented church in court in case, you know, we get sued. And then no benevolence is shown. I love benevolence. Benevolence is supposed to be there. Amen? I was reading this book called Church Administration by Charles Tidwell, and he's one of the Southern Baptist Church. And this is the guidelines that he gives with regards to organization. It should reflect the theology. It should lead toward clearly defined goals. It should be as simple as possible. It should be flexible. Jobs are grouped together, and responsibilities matched with authority. Clear guidelines, and then there you go. congregation authority should be clear. So I don't think it's clear here. Now what is happening is this. And so we, the board of trustees, were elected by you, the members. Now, that's why we're here. And the members, the trustees are in charge of administration, which composed of the finance, pastoral support, personnel, buildings and grounds, and maintenance. Now, if you look at that, and if you read the book, what does it show? It shows that our focus is it outward or inward? Inward. So, in other words, the Board of Trustees has been leading our congregation towards an inward focus of attention, which could kill the church. So I think that somehow the two should be merged. What I'm thinking of is when the board meets on the second Sunday of every month, the elders should be there, the board of trustees should be there, and then this new group should be called either the church board, not board of trustees, church board, or the church council. And this should be the highest making body of the church, because then we can talk to each other. Well, that's just my idea. Exodus says, when I'm saying this, I'm looking at Quiroli. Moses' father-in-law replied. Who's the father-in-law of Moses? Jethro, very good. Who is, if you can answer this, I'll give you this book. Who is the wife of Moses? Oh, there you go. The daughter of Jethro, Zipporah. I'll give you the book, Malu. You can give it to somebody else. Moses' father-in-law replied, "What you are doing is not good. You and these people who come to you will only wear yourselves out. The work is too heavy for you. You cannot handle it alone. Listen now to me, and I will give you some advice, and may God be with you. You must be the people's representative before God and bring their disputes to him. Teach them his decrees and instructions and show them the way they are to live and how they are to behave. But select capable men," Article 3, the statement of purpose of our constitution. So what does Article 3 say? The purpose of ICF, it says, is number one, evangelism. Bring people to the saving faith of Christ. Number two, discipleship. Teach people the word of God. Number three, worship. Involve people in dynamic prayer and worship. Mission, equip people for and involve people in service. And number five, fellowship. Build people through healthy personal relationships. Now, I'd like you to notice one thing. It's all bring people. Teach people. Involve people. Equip people, build people. In other words, it's saying that it's not just a certain number of individuals who are supposed to be doing each of this. All of us are supposed to be following evangelism, discipleship, worship, mission, and fellowship. All of us, not just certain people. So wouldn't it be nice if we have a program that will allow us to go through each of this, like not just certain people, but the whole church? So in order to do that, let's ask a few critical questions. Number one, why are we here? Number two, why does ICF exist? Number three, what does God want to accomplish through us? And number four, how are we going to accomplish this? Critical questions, very important, we need to answer. If we really analyze this and we go through the Bible and we pray about this, we are going to realize that the answer to this is God wants us to be intentional about making disciples. That is the bottom line. That is what it boils down to. So it's shown in the great commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, which is worship. Love your neighbor as yourself, ministry. The great commission, go and make disciples, which is evangelism, baptizing them, fellowship, and teaching them to obey discipleship. This is repeated over and over and over again in the Bible. In Acts chapter 2, and this is the favorite verse of Quiroli, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common, selling their possessions and goods. They gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere heart. The result, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Now, what does this say? It says that if we do all of this, if we do the discipleship, the worship, the ministry, the fellowship, God promises this. In other words, we should look at things differently. God is going to be behind us when we do our evangelism. But we need to do the rest first. So, my proposal is we do everything simple. Simple is good, not simple is not good. For example, Google. If you type google.com, it's just a white screen with a blank. If you go yahoo.com, it's so cluttered. Yahoo, I read in Washington Post, is going to be selling their internet business to the Chinese. Yeah. iPhone went on iPod. You know, iPod, the music player. When it first came out, everybody was like skeptical about it because it only had one button. Now all cell phones only have one button. So simple. Simple is the way to go. Simple churches are growing and complex churches are struggling. But simple does not mean easy. It might be simple, but it's not easy. There are a few requirements. Number one, everything should fit together. The process should be simple, and it moves forward, people forward to maturity. And there are four elements: clarity. Pastor Sam mentioned this earlier. Clarity, movement, alignment, and focus. Clarity meaning everybody should be aware of the process. Movement means it moves the person from one level towards the next. Alignment means everything has to be to lead towards that goal. And focus, those that do not lead towards the goal should be eliminated. So, what is this process we're talking about? This one. What it is the circles of commitment. Community, or the unchurched and occasional attenders. So they would occasionally come here. The crowd is the regular attenders. Congregation are the members. Committed are maturing members. And the core are the lay ministers. What I propose is... Oh, it's not working. Anyway. How come? Okay. What I suppose is... So ICF should push our members from the outer level of commitment going towards the inside. And how do we do this? Is first, we invite, like Pastor Sam mentioned earlier, we invite people from who are not going to church, who come occasionally. And the invite I'm talking about is to not just say, I'll meet you in church, but we go pick them up, bring them here, attend the worship, maybe have lunch, and then bring them back home. And then the next Sunday, we do it again. When they come here, they'll now be member of the crowd. The crowd is where they're attending the worship service every Sunday. So, and then once they are here, inside, a special team will be taking care of them, which is the assimilation team, which will be headed by Malda, Doris, Beth, et al. And I'd like to encourage everyone else to join this team. What they will be doing is they will be monitoring the visitors. All right? And their main job is for them to connect the visitors to people who are members of ICF. So if a visitor is a male nurse who is in the military, introduce them to Jojo. Or if the person is from the Philippines and he comes from, say, Bulacan, introduce him to Kuya Rolly. Something like that. We look for familiar elements and connect them. It's a very important team. We should pray and support them. So they have been attending. And then once they are comfortable here and they see how our lifestyle is lived, then it's now a good opportunity for us to present to them the gospel. And so, Oh, by the way, when they're here, we also have them join the small groups because that's where they will grow. So once they're comfortable attending worship services here, we now ask Emily and her team to share the gospel with them. And they will now realize that they are saved. And then once they are saved, they will be baptized. And once they are baptized, they are now members of ICF. They'll go through a class, the new beginners class, and then ICF. And then after that, we put them inside one of the E12 groups, right? So it's a long process. Once they finish their E12, they are now lay ministers. By the time they reach here, Kuya Rolly can, like, I would like to serve the old people. Then the first thing we're going to ask them is, who would you like your members to be? Because by the time you reach there, you're going to have this discontent that Pastor Sam is talking about, and you'd like to change the community, you'd like to change the world. ICF will help you in doing that. But you have to go through the process. So if we look at it, the outer part is evangelism, and then coming to worship. And then once they become membership, they're part of the fellowship. And then they join the E12, discipleship, and ministry. So this is what I propose we do. We should move our members deeper and deeper towards a deeper level of community. Number one, we need to pray. None of this will work if we don't pray. Amen? Second, we need to invite. Very important, we need to invite. We will not grow if we don't invite. Third, we need to invite. And guess what number four is? Amen. So this is what we need to do. So in closing, this is my phone number, 845-536-117. So you can text me or call me anytime. I usually stay up to like 1 o'clock in the morning. And then that's my email, stringchicken@verizon.net. Kuya Ate Malda likes that very much. I have a 3-minute video, if I can show it to you, just to explain how the process is going to go. So can I have the video, guys?
We all start as baby Christians, but God wants us to grow and to mature. 1 Corinthians 13:11 says, "When I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away all childish things." Hebrews 5:14 says, "But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil." ICF is your training ground. ICF moves you from being a baby Christian to becoming a minister. ICF takes you through a process, a series of programs designed to make you be more matured and more committed in your relationship with our Lord Jesus. You probably came to ICF as an attender, where you joined us for worship service. But you don't have to be an attender for the rest of your life. We encourage you to move forward and to mature so that you can experience the rewards of being a Christian. Join the membership class, where the basics of being a Christian and the expectation of being an ICF member is taught. When you are ready to declare that you are a child of God, be baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and become an official member of ICF. Join a small group where a lot of learning and caring and support for one another takes place. Have yourself assigned to one of the discipleship groups. Here you will have an in-depth study of the Word of God, where you will mature in your Christian